لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب ما كان حديثا يفترى ولكن تصديق الذي بين يديه وتفصيل كل شيء وهدى ورحمة لقوم يؤمنون.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أهلا وسهلا ومرحبا بكم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وبه نستعين، وأصلي وأسلم على خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد بن عبد الله الهاشمي القرشي وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. قال تبارك وتعالى في محكم التنزيل: ما كان محمد أبا أحد من رجالكم ولكن رسول الله وخاتم النبيين. صدق الله العظيم. Respected viewers, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أهلا وسهلا ومرحبا بكم. A warm and a hearty welcome once again on this beautiful episode on the sublime, pristine conduct of the Anbiya alayhim as-salam, of the noble prophets, may peace be upon them, and on the lifestyle of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala send his deepest salutations upon our noble master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Indeed, we are honored to be amongst the ummah of the final ummah and the final prophet of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we are indeed fortunate to be amongst those that have iman. Falhamdulillah ala dhalik. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for iman. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for Islam. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us beautiful, lives. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, you know, every aspect of our bodies, every aspect of our lives, every little, part of our body. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For imagine, if a man, you know, has eyes today and tomorrow goes blind, how much would he appreciate to have those eyesight back? So we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for everything that we have. And like we normally say, Alhamdulillah ala kulli hal. All praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon every condition that we face. Inshallah, in today's three segments on the sublime conduct of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Anbiya alayhi wa sallam, we'll be speaking of, inshallah, you know, last week we terminated by speaking on when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the different years, what happened in different years of his life. We stopped by when they went for the first hijrah to Abyssinia, to Ethiopia as we know it today, Habasha, wherein the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told the Sahaba, O my Sahaba, migrate to the land of Allah, wherein you can make amal and practice upon the deen of Islam, the deen of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, openly, without any obstructions, any hurdles. Inna deena inda Allah al-Islam. And the Sahaba done so by going to Abyssinia, migrating to the land of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, migrating to Abyssinia, to the land of Najashi. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy for them. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala put rahmah and put mercy in the eyes of in the heart of Najashi, so that he saw favorably upon the Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. Even after the Meccans came to Abyssinia, telling the king of Abyssinia, Najashi, we want our people back so that we may deal with them. Najashi, after hearing the story of Maryam alayhi salam, the Virgin Mary, from Ja'far bin Abi Talib radiallahu an, the cousin of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he tells the Meccans that even if you give me all the wealth in the world, I will never give them up to you. Never ever. And they live in the land of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the land of Najashi, and they practice upon Islam openly. Now thereafter, remember, once the Meccans heard that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's people are in Abyssinia or in Habasha, and they are openly spreading Islam, talking about Islam, and Najashi gave them freedom. Now what do they do? Next step, sanctions, boycott. Let's start boycotting them. Remember, everybody in Makkah al-Mukarramah do not deal with the Muslims. Everybody in Makkah al-Mukarramah have sanctions against them. And what do the people of Makkah do? They have sanctions against the Muslimin, against the Mu'mineen. It's them and Allah.
So remember, this happened in the year 616 Hijri, or the year 616 before the actual Hijrah, before the actual Hijrah, and the actual Hijrah was to Medina Munawwara. Now imagine what a tough time they go through, subhanAllah, Allahu Akbar. What a tough time the believers go through. What a tough time. Sanctions against them. In today's time we see, if a certain country has sanctions, that country becomes crippled, can't do nothing. Why? Because the entire globe, the entire world put together, nobody sends them goods to sell, goods to trade with, nobody sends them whatever it may be, and they are sanctioned, petrol and so forth, etc., etc. Like we see today in neighboring Zimbabwe, you know. So people have sanctions against them, and like we South Africa had in the apartheid time when we had sanctions. Now imagine, this, a handful of people, the Meccans boycott them, sanctions against them. You cannot do business with these people, can't do nothing with them. And everybody has sanctions against the mu'mineen, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's rahmah comes upon them. In the year 620, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with all the hardship, remember, the Quran al-Kareem, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him to go to other places and give, you know, a da'wah openly. He goes to Taif, neighboring Taif. He goes to Taif, which is very, very close to Makkah al-Mukarramah, to give them da'wah ila Allah, to call the people to one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one God, the God of Abraham, the Lord of Moses, the Lord of Jesus, my Allah, your Allah, the Lord of, you know, the sustainer and the nourisher of the entire universe, whatever it contains. He goes there with Zayd radiallahu anhu. And as they go into Taif, oh people, come to one Allah. Come to one Allah. Worship one Allah. Leave the worship of idols. You cannot worship a stone. That certain stone that you create with your own hands cannot harm you, nor can it benefit you. Now, one point that we see here among the sublime conduct of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he's in Taif, subhanAllah. When he's in Taif, people come to one Allah. All he's doing is giving a message. He's giving a message. Now just imagine, we have our own president, President Nelson Mandela, right? He, in the apartheid time, he was giving, you know, going to people, giving messages. You know what? Let's have democracy. Let's have freedom. And this is what he was doing. You know, what did the people do? They hurt him, tortured him, they jailed him. The apartheid regime jailed him. And what was his message? One simple, peaceful message. Let's have freedom. Democracy to the people. And how was he treated? The very same manner. Inshallah, after the break, we'll be speaking on what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam done and how he was treated and how people came back and gave him the approach. On the other hand, how they approached him and hurt him. We'll be back shortly. Stay tuned.
لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب.
Welcome back. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أهلا وسهلا ومرحبا بكم. الحمد لله. We are on the second segment of the sublime conduct of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم's noble life. On today's episode, I am your host Hammad Timur. الحمد لله. Just to inform all our viewers out there, you can, you know, follow us on Twitter or like our Facebook page. Our Twitter account, Hammad 6, that's HAMMAAD, the number 6, that's Hammad 6. You can follow us or like our Facebook page, Hammad Timur. Yes, before the break, we were speaking about, you know, going to Taif, giving a simple message and what the people done. Like our own president, President Nelson Mandela, in the time of the apartheid, you know, going to the people, telling them, you know what, all I want from you and I ask from you is one man, one vote. On the other hand, democracy to the people. You know, leave all this, you know, segregation and sanction on the people and let the people have their say. Freedom to all. What they done? 27 years of his life, they basically put him into a cell, a prison. And he fought for the country, right? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just imagine, going to Taif, they done worse to him, much worse. They hurt him, they hit him, they swore at him, they tortured him, they put thorns in his blessed feet until his beloved ankles were covered in blood. The angels come down, Ya Rasulullah, give us permission. We will crush this nation between two mountains. Ya Rasulullah, give us the go-ahead. Just give us one call and they are finished, they are terminated. will destroy them, annihilate them. What does he do? What will me and you do, respective viewers? How will we react? What will we do? What does he do? Allahumma inni ashku ilayka dha'fa quwwati. Oh Allah, oh my God, oh Allah, I complain to you of my weakness. I am weak. That is why they hurt me. Allahumma ahdi qawmi fa innahum la ya'lamun. Oh Allah, guide my people, for they don't know what they do. This was his sublime, pristine conduct. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What will me and you do? Bring an army to fight back with them. Somebody hurts us at our workplace. We go back and get an entire army to come and fight them. This is our reaction. So are we followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? But did he do this? No. Let's react in the manner he reacted. If somebody swears at you, you know, like they say, amazing, amazing. Sticks and stones will break my bones, but names will never harm me. And very true. Let them swear you. Let them mock at you. How much will they do it? How much can they do it? What does it make you smaller? Does it make you more, does it make you poorer? No, it only elevates your status. Remember, من تواضع لله رفعه الله. Whoever humbles himself for the pleasure of Allah, Allah will elevate his status. So, the very same men are going to Taif, giving da'wah ila Allah, giving da'wah to Islam, calling the people. What are they telling the people? Come to one Allah. Leave the worship of your forefathers, the worship of idols, the worship of stones, which you create with your own hands. How can it harm you? How can it benefit you? You are leaving fruit in front of this idol. Does it eat? No, it lies there until it rots. You are leaving maize, wheat, barley in front of the certain idol. Can it eat? No. It only rots away. So remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pure. Subhanallah al-azim wa bihamdi. Allah is pure, the pure being. And the message to the people of Taif was come to one Allah. In the year 621 Hijri, subhanallah, 621 before Hijri, the Rasul of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has the honor of visiting Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala and making Isra and Mi'raj. Subhana alladhi asra bi'abdihi laylan min al-masjid al-haram ila al-masjid al-aqsa alladhi barakna hawla. Allahu Akbar. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, you know, takes Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from Makkah al-Mukarrama to where? Baytul Muqaddas. Subhanallah. From where to where? Now, in those times, people could never imagine. Why? In one night. Now we can imagine it. Today I sit in a plane at 8:30 in the evening, 8:30 p.m. But the next morning, I'm in the States. The next morning, I'm in Saudi Arabia. The next morning, I'm in Australia. I'm in Dubai, Abu Dhabi. You know, so within a couple of hours, I'm in another part of the globe. So remember, if it's easy for a human being, it's nothing for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Kun fayakun. Be, and it was done. So remember, today for us, it's not hard to fathom and imagine. But the people of that time, obviously, if they traveled for 200 kilometers or 200 miles, it took them an entire day or entire 2, 3, 4 days, entire week. For us today, a couple of thousands of miles, we sit on the flight today at O.R. Tambo International Airport in Johannesburg, and within 8 hours, we are in Dubai. Or within 12 hours, we are in Malaysia. So remember, it's not the fiqh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took his beloved Habib Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from Makkah al-Mukarramah to where? To Bayt al-Muqaddas. And there Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made salah. He made salah and he led prayer. And who did he lead in salah? The Anbiya alayhim as-salam. All the Anbiya alayhim as-salam in prayer. So it shows he was afdhal al-khalq wa akram al-rusul. Khatam al-Anbiya, the final prophet. Yet, he led all the other Anbiya alayhim as-salam in prayer. And from here, with the Buraq, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes him to the seven heavens. Subhanallah al-Azim wa bihamdi. Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes him to Sidratul Muntaha, the place where nobody ever went, not even Jibreel alayhi salam. فكان كعب قوسين أو أدنى فأوحى إلى عبده ما أوحى ما كذب الفؤاد ما رأى سبحان الله. In the Mi'raj from بيت المقدس, he ascends to the heavens. Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم ascends to the heavens, And now it might become difficult for us to fathom in today, in those times. But today we see NASA going to the moon, going to Mars, going to Jupiter, going to Saturn, going so wherever, you know, touring the universe. What is so difficult for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Going for Mi'raj, to, you know, to the heavens, ascend to the heavens. Now, when he comes to the heavens, subhanallah, from this we see why he ascends to the heavens. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls him to give him one of the best gifts ever. The best gifts after Iman. The gift of Salah. And on every sky, he meets different Anbiya alayhim salam. He meets Adam alayhi salam. And Adam alayhi salam says, welcome to an honored son and the greatest Nabi. He meets Isa alayhi salam. Welcome to an honored brother. He meets Yusuf alayhi salam. And he's taken back by his beauty. Ibrahim alayhi salam. Ismail alayhi salam. Subhanallah al-Azim. So he meets different Anbiya alayhi salam on different skies. And they all welcome him. Subhanallah. And after the break, inshallah, we'll speak more on the Mi'raj. And what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam done in disguise, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him. And the final segment, inshallah, we'll be speaking on the akhlaq and the character of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Stay tuned.
لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب.
Welcome back. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ahlan wa sahlan wa marhaban bikum. The third segment of today's episode on the sublime conduct of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik wa an'im ala abdika wa rasulika Muhammadin afdal al-khalq wa akram al-rusul wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala sends peace and salam and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon all his family and all those that follow him until the day of reckoning. Ameen, ya Rabbil Alameen. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before the break we spoke about Isra and Mi'raj, came to the heavens. Once he comes to the heavens, he meets all the different Anbiya alayhi wa sallam on different skies. Musa alayhi salam, Moses, Jesus, Adam, Abraham, subhanallah. And goes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, shown Jannah and Jahannam. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala gives him the gift of Salah. Directly, subhanallah. So from this viewers, we can actually imagine how important Salah is in the eyes of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a lot of times if you want to give a gift to somebody, you'll just post it, DHL, you know, Fastway, couriers, whatever it may be, UTI. But a lot of times if you want to give that person something very, very important, heart to heart, hand to hand, in other words, you call the person and give it to him indirectly in his hands. And this was what was done here. Allah called him to Allah and gave him the message and the gift of Salah. And first, 50 Salah was made compulsory upon the believers. And as he's coming back, on the way he meets Musa alayhi salam. Ya Rasulullah, what was given to you? 50 Salah. Go to Allah and ask Allah to reduce it. Reduce the amount because my nation could not follow it. Too difficult. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes back to Allah to request if Allah could lower the number. And thereafter, it was 3 or 4 times he came back to Musa and back to Allah, and until the amount was 5, like we see today. And for the 5th time, Musa alayhi salam says, go back to Allah and tell Allah, request Allah to make it lower. And now Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, I feel shy to go to my Lord and ask him to lower the number now. And this is how the 5 salah became incumbent and compulsory upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's ummah once they mature. Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib and Asha. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us steadfast on our salah. Inna salata kanat ala min al-kitab maquta. Verily the salah are ordained on different times upon the believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us steadfast upon our salah. For salah is as-salatu miftahu al-jannah. Salah is the key to Jannah. As-salatu miftahu al-jannah. Salah is the key to Jannah. So remember, you want a key to open the door? Then remember, viewers out there, keep steadfast on your salah. All the other Anbiya alayhim salam had salah in their lives. Remember, subhanallah, Moses, the Prophet Moses, when Allah spoke to him, when God spoke to Moses, what did Allah say? إني أنا الله لا إله إلا أنا فاعبدني وأقم الصلاة لذكري. أو موسى I am Allah لا إله إلا أنا there is no God but me وأقم الصلاة لذكري فاعبدني worship me alone وأقم الصلاة لذكري and perform salah for my remembrance. Remember Musa إن الساعة الآتية قيامة is coming, the last hour is coming, the final hour is coming. أو موسى عيسى Jesus when he spoke in his mother's arms, when his mother pointed towards him, the Virgin Mary, when she pointed towards him, فأشارت إليه قالوا, they said, كيف نكلم من كان في المهد صبية? What did the people say? Oh Mary, how can a baby speak? What did he say? إني عبد الله, I am the messenger of Allah. آتاني الكتاب. God gave me the book. وجعلني نبيا. And he made me a prophet. وجعلني مباركا أينما كنت. And he made me a means of blessing wherever I am. And what did God command me thereafter? وَأَوْصَانِي بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ مَا دُمْتُ حَيَّةِ Allah commanded me to perform salah and give alms, charity, zakat. مَا دُمْتُ حَيَّةِ As long as I live. So every prophet that came to this world, Jesus, Moses, were all commanded to tell their people to remember Allah. How? With salah. With salah. The mu'mineen, the believers, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was given the command of salah. Perform salah for my remembrance. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given this certain gift of salah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly. Now remember, this was the Isra and Mi'raj. And thereafter, the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, imagine his humbleness. Subhanallah. He went beyond a place nobody ever went. Not even Jibreel alayhi salam. And the Meccans thereafter said, oh, you know what? Oh, Muhammad is a madman. A'udhu billah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Bakr, your friend claims to go to Allah, to the heavens. And he said, I believe him. Radiyallahu anhu wa radhu an. Radiyallahu an. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala be pleased with Abu Bakr. If qala li sahib, subhanallah. If qala li sahibihi, la tahsa inna Allah ma'ana. This, inshallah, will be coming to later on. Thereafter, in the year 622, they plot to kill Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Meccans plot to kill him. And from now, what does he do? He takes his friend Abu Bakr and they migrate to Medina Munawwara. He puts his cousin Ali, his paternal cousin Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu an, the son of Abu Talib, in his bed at night. And the Meccans come to his house early in the early part of the morning to kill him. And who do they find in his bed? Ali. And subhanallah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passes them with the help of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blinded them from seeing him. And this Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, respective viewers, and his friend Abu Bakr. And why I say his friend Abu Bakr, migrate to Medina Munawwara. And from here, the Islamic calendar starts off, the hijrah starts off. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala nabiyyuna Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Indeed brings tears to one's eyes, respected viewers, that from here the hijrah starts. What hardship he and Abu Bakr go through. What hardship they go through. They go into the cave of Thur and they hide there. You know, subhanAllah, the pigeon lays an egg. The spider makes a web. So when the kuffar and the disbelievers and the Meccans run behind them, and they come to the cave where they were hiding. Abu Bakr is right there in the cave. The Meccans are right outside waiting them, waiting to enter. And they see the pigeon lays an egg right in front of the mouth of the cave and spider webs. They feel to themselves, ah, nobody can enter here because obviously the webs will be broken. Abu Bakr is in tears. He's scared for his life. They're going to kill us today. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِذْ قَالَ لِصَاحِبِهِ لَا تَحْزَنْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَنَا. That, oh Abu Bakr, do not fear. Oh, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells in the Quran and says in the Quran, when he addresses his friend, who addresses who? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, addressing his friend Abu Bakr. لَا تَحْزَنْ. Don't worry, Allah is with us. So from here, we can actually see the proof that Abu Bakr was the true friend of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We'll leave it there for today, inshallah. Next week, inshallah, speaking more and complete until, you know, all the years until the demise of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But today we learned on the sublime conduct, the akhlaq, of Muhammad bin Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His sabr, his patience he went through. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us staunch followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Until we meet again, inshallah, from myself, Hamad Timur, just to inform the viewers once more, you can follow us on Twitter at Hamad6, Hamad, that's H-A-M-M-A-D-6, or you can like our Facebook page, from myself, Hamad Timur, and my everybody out there, inshallah, until we meet again. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب ما كان حديثا يفترى ولكن تصديق الذي بين يديه وتفصيل كل شيء وهدى ورحمة لقوم يؤمنون.